Will Wilson. I'm one of the park rangers here. And ironically enough, Tim here decided that the New Yorker was best suited to deliver the session on topography and geography, neglecting the fact that he's got a native Mississippian on staff that is from the very region that this area involves. So we are this evening going to, in fact, revisit a little bit of the topography and the geography area of Vicksburg, because it does play a very crucial role in the fortifications that are constructed here by the Confederate Army. Vicksburg is, in fact, already a fortress because of its location. It is located on a hairpin turn in the Mississippi River, resting on bluffs some 250 feet above the Mississippi. The topography that we're going to look at are two parts. The Mississippi Yazoo Delta, this area here, and then the lowest hills, the lowest bluffs. The Mississippi Delta, which is the area in green, is some 4.5 million acres. It is 200 miles long by 85 miles wide at its widest. For those that...
Are you on?
I thought it was, but now I am.
Now you're in surround sound.
Now I'm in surround sound. Very good. For those of us that are from Mississippi, one of the key points that is made oftentimes is that the Delta starts at the lobby of the Peabody Hotel and ends at Catfish Row at Vicksburg, Mississippi. The area that is known as the Mississippi Delta isn't, in fact, of course, the official definition of a delta is an alluvial plain. And during the time of the Civil War, it acted as a defense for Vicksburg. The Yazoo River Basin, it is Mississippi's largest basin and drains about 13,000 square miles. And it actually covers about 30 counties of present-day Mississippi. This is the Yazoo River Basin. The darker blue is the Yazoo River. It has its confluence at Greenwood, Mississippi, where the Tallahatchie River and the Yallabusha River conjoin, the Yazoo River forming there and then flowing south past Yazoo City until it reaches the Mississippi River. All of the light blue rivers and streams are other rivers that drain this entire region, as well as even East Mississippi, because it is all flowing towards the Mississippi River, which you did see on Tim's slide. So you did have the Tallahatchie, the Yallabusha, the Big Sunflower River, and it has several tributaries joining it. You would have had Deer Creek, which is also used in some of the Bayou campaigns in 1862. I believe Jake's going to get into some of that. And Steel Bayou, of course, the Steel Bayou campaign, which is an effort to try and get around Vicksburg and come in from behind. In the mid-19th century, though, the Yazoo Mississippi Delta is not the region of the agricultural producing region of the state of Mississippi like we know it today. It is, in fact, a hardwood swamp with cypress and sweet gum. The interior of the Mississippi Delta is still almost impenetrable. So there are no railroads, very few roads, and what settlements there are, only about 8 to 10, reside on the rivers, like the Big Sunflower and Steel Bayou and such. So this area is, in fact, another defense to Vicksburg. We're not going to talk about the lowest hills. Some people call them the lowest bluffs. These, as Tim mentioned, are a windblown sediment type soil that date to the prehistoric times when the glaciers melted. As those glaciers were treated out of the Midwest, that lowest soil is deposited and it's brought down the rivers, and then a windstorm picks it up, blows it against the east side of the Mississippi River, creating the lowest bluffs. And this is, in fact, what makes Vicksburg so defensible. It is these narrow ridges and deep, steep ravines that you will certainly see in the park that make Vicksburg a fortress unlike any that military engineers had seen before. The Confederate rear line of defense is what is referred to when we are talking about the Confederate defensive positions that were placed to the east of the city, some 2 miles out from the city center, along a ridge line that would have stretched from the north of the city to the south of the city. We would have also, of course, had river batteries in place along strategic points protecting the river. It is a system of redoubts, redans, lunettes, field works, connecting them by rifle pits so as to give a continuous line of defense. This is a quote by Major Samuel Lockett, who is the chief engineer, and we'll get to him in just a second. There are 9 major fortifications guarding access points into the city. It's what we would call a rapid avenue of approach today, as a military term. All of the roads, the railroad, Fort Garrett, guarding a little valley that kind of swoops into the south part of the city. All of these fortifications are then going to be connected by rifle trenches. So you had Fort Hill. That's going to be our tour stop 9 in the park. It's going to anchor the left flank of the Confederate defensive line. You had the Stockade Redan complex, and it is referred to as Stockade Redan, but it was more of a complex than just one particular redan. There were 3 major fortifications guarding the Graveyard Road into the city of Vicksburg, called the Graveyard Road because it comes right beside the city cemetery. Third Louisiana Redan, guarding the north part of the Jackson Road entrance into the city. Called that because the 3rd Louisiana Infantry is positioned in this fortification. The Great Redoubt positions to the south of the Jackson Road. And in it, you had the 21st and 22nd Louisiana. One of the things to note is that there was one Captain David H. Todd of the 21st Louisiana at that location. You might not know David H. Todd, but I'm sure you've heard of his sister, Mary Todd Lincoln. Now, the 2nd Texas Lunette, just behind us here where the Jewish cemetery is located today, was guarding the Baldwin Ferry Road into the entrance into the city. I called that because of the 2nd Texas Infantry positioned in that fortification. Just across from it, the Railroad Redoubt guarding the railroad cut. Last thing you would want Grant to be able to do is just march right down the railroad and into the city. So the fortification was built guarding that location. Fort Garrett, again, guarding a little valley that kind of swoops into the south part of the city. You know, any type of egress that is easily obtained, you want to make sure that there is a defensive position there. It is called Fort Garrett because Colonel Isham W. Garrett, Colonel of the 20th Alabama, who assumes command of Brigadier General Edward D. Tracy's brigade after Tracy is killed at the Battle of Port Gibson on May 17th, right here at Fort Garrett. H.M.W. Garrett, it gets tired of all of the sharpshooters that are taking shots at his men, so he decides to pick up a rifle and take a shot back when he gets one in the chest and is killed. Just a few days later, he does get the notice that he has been promoted to Brigadier General, and in his honor, then the fortification is named for him. Before that, it was known as Square Fort, and you will see why in just a moment. You also had the Salient Work, which was right here. It was guarding the Halls Ferry Road entrance into the city. And South Fort, which is right here. And this, South Fort anchors the right flank of the Confederate line. Major Samuel Lockett graduates second in his class from United States Military Academy at West Point. He is the chief engineer here for the Confederate defenses. He did rise to the rank of colonel and to chief engineer of Army of the Tennessee. After the war, he did teach at Louisiana State University and at University of Tennessee. Lockett also serves as principal assistant engineer in the construction of the pedestal for the Statue of Liberty. Lockett would spend months reconnoitering and surveying and studying the terrain that was given to him, and he is quoted as saying, "The complicated and irregular site to be fortified, no greater topographical puzzle was ever presented to a military engineer." This is a fortification of Stockade Redan, which we do see today. We've been talking about these fortifications, redans, redoubts, and lunettes. Well, what are they? This is one question that we always answer. The handout that you got this evening gives a little bit of explanation about each one and also how these fortifications would have been constructed. A redan. It's French for projection or salient. You can see it's basically an upside down V with that apex pointing out. It's going to be pointing out towards your enemy. What it's going to do is it's going to be able to allow you to cross your fire. If you have a straight line of defenses, all you can do is just shoot straight ahead. Once you put a redan, one of these angles in your defenses, you can now cross your fire at any incoming enemy. Lunette, French, which is a diminutive of lune, which is French for moon, and therefore that term lunette. Again, a open area in the rear, much like a redan. The lunette is going to give you much of the same concept behind the redan where you can cross your fire. You are just getting a little bit more coverage with the lunette, and it's oftentimes more of a crescent shape than this diagram here. Redoubt is French for refuge, and it was a square type fortification with an opening to the rear. This allowed for your men to actually get reinforcements, to get resupplied, while still being protected on three sides. The profile of these fortifications looks something like this. The exterior slope you see here would have been in front of it a ditch about 8 feet wide, and you're looking at anywhere from 17 to 26 feet from the bottom of the ditch to the top of the parapet wall. You would have had a firing step that allowed soldiers to lean over the parapet wall to place fire. The terraplane was often floored for artillery, And the artillery is going to fire through a hole in the fortification called an embrasure. This was a diorama in the Missouri State Historical Museum. Thanks to Jake for finding that. It's a really neat diorama. This particular one showcases the Stockade Redan complex. This perhaps is the Stockade Redan, or Green's Redan, off to the right of the Stockade Redan. You can see the floors that would have been laid down for firing artillery. Here is the embrasure. The logs that you see would have been cut first by the Confederate soldiers. They begin constructing these fortifications in the fall of 1862. What trees were on the battlefield that had not been cut by settlers and such for cultivating crops and grazing livestock, these soldiers are going to go out and cut them down. You are going to want a clear field of fire, and of course you can use those logs to help build your fortification. And there are three purposes of field fortifications. The first one is, of course, to provide protection against incoming fire. You are going to want to be able to have yourself in a place that you are less likely going to receive wounds from enemy fire. So these fortifications do provide that. The second is also you're going to place obstacles in front of the path of any of these oncoming enemy troops so that they will be unable to get very close to your position. You want to slow them up, allow for you to be able to fire at their location, and if they're not advancing at a rapid pace and they're just held up, slow moving, you've got an easy target. And three is to provide a clear field of fire some 50 to 100 yards wide and at least 300 to 400 yards in length in which the defenders could fire upon the attackers. And what this is going to do is the last thing that you want is for somebody that is attacking your position to have a place of refuge themselves. So if they can hide behind trees, then they are certainly going to do that. As well, you see that if you have just 50 yards of cleared area, beyond that is a row of trees, well, your enemy can mass in those trees, hiding their numbers, offering protection, and thus making it harder for you to detect how many there are and their oncoming positions towards you. Fortifications would have had reinforcements. This is not a basket, although it does have a name, and it's gabion, which is actually French for basket. It is a cylindrical basket open at both ends. It's going to be open here and open down at the bottom. It will be filled with dirt, and it can be used as a revetment to form parapets on the trenches, and we'll show you this photograph here. These are gabions, and then what we see right here are the fascines. Fascines are tightly bound bundles of wood. You basically would have gone out and cut down small trees and taken the limbs and branches off of taller trees, bundled together, tied them up, and that's going to give you a place to place these gabions on top of, building you an additional wall, if you will, more protection from incoming artillery fire, and again, it's going to help fortify your own position. I just saw some photographs of the in the news, of course, all the stuff going on in the Crimea area with Russia and the Ukraine. The Crimean War, of course, is 1851 to 1856, and you see a lot of this type stuff even in that war as well. You would have also placed obstacles in front of your fortification. Obstacles, again, are going to slow your the enemy's advancement towards your position. This row of sticks you see here are called palisades. It is French from impaling, basically. Any number of pales or stakes pointed at the top, so they are going to be all sharpened here at the top, set in the ground in a row of others to form a defense to your position. Enemy soldier attacking this location here has to come through this before he can get to here. Anybody know what this is? Abattis. That's correct. French from abattre, or to fell. It's an ospable formed basically when you sharpen limbs or branches into points. You're going to stack them all in a big pile. Sometimes these abattis are anywhere from 4 to 5 feet thick and anywhere from 5 to 6 feet high, depending on what was available. And so, of course, the Confederate soldiers would have, what trees they did cut down. They're not just going to burn that scrap wood. They are making these abattis. And these are going to be in those deep ravines. So as Grant's army makes these assaults on May 19th, on May 22nd, they are going to have to go through these. And at some points, they do leave gaps in these abattis, making it a firing field so they can concentrate their fire at that one gap, because if you see a gap, you're going to try to run through it. Well, it offered the Confederate soldiers a clear line to that gap, and of course caused the Federal soldiers to rethink their efforts. Shibota Free. Shibota Free actually date to the Middle Ages. They would have been placed in front of castles and such. It was a log that had been had holes drilled in it, and then smaller branches that had also been sharpened at the top into points, placed in front of your defensive position, and it is literally, chevaux is French for horse, and de free is the free land, which was where we see in the Netherlands today, these Frisians would have been trying to attack places in France, and so these actually were invented, and we today they still even call them chevaux de free. They even date, you even see them in World War II. If you look at ever pictures of Normandy, all of those iron jacks that are on the beaches of Normandy, those are chevaux de frise. They're not made out of logs and sticks, but made out of iron. They're not stopping horses, they're trying to stop tanks. So you can see the progression of military type earthworks even into the 20th century. This is a painting of Thayer's Approach. That's our tour stop number 6 along the tour road. It was painted by a soldier that was here just a little while after the war, but you see the soldiers here, these Union soldiers that are making gabions and fascines. The tunnel that was reaching up here are the Confederate lines. When you drive out to Tour Stop 6, you know, you see that this area is clear. You've got a ridge on your left, a ridge on your right. Those are the sharpshooter lines that we see. And the tunnel that was dug, even though you've got the one, of course, under the tour road, they did do this as well, trying to dig their approach to the top of the Confederate lines there, where the 26th Louisiana is positioned. You're basically digging a ditch, but what they're doing is they're putting these fascines over the top so that the Confederates cannot just shoot down into their approach trench. Of course, Vicksburg is on the Mississippi River. That's why it makes it so vital, such a strategic location. But again, the thing to remember is that at this time in 1863, Memphis is under Union control, Baton Rouge is under Union control, New Orleans is under Union control. All three of those cities do have a railhead. Of course, now that they are under Union control, no supplies from the states of Arkansas, Louisiana, Texas can get across the river. Vicksburg is still the only Confederate-held railhead holding the two halves of the Confederacy together. And so, along the river were placed 13 batteries that are guarding it. Basically, as a vessel would turn the bend at DeSoto Point, he would be under the guns from the water battery, from Fort Hill, battery number 7, battery number 6, battery number 5, battery number 4, and we're coming into the city, Wyman's Hill Battery, the Whig Office Battery, the Depot Battery, the Brooks Battery, Marine Hospital Battery, the Widow Blakely Battery, and then of course South Fort. This was a stretch of about 4.5 miles that any vessel, as they would come around the bend, is going to be under the constant bombardment from these river batteries. They were under the command of Colonel Edward Higgins. Colonel Higgins is, before the war, actually serves in the Navy for 20 years. He entered the Confederate States Army on April 12, 1861, as a captain in the 1st Louisiana Artillery. He does supervise the construction of the defenses of Ship Island, and he was promoted to colonel on September 26, 1862, and assigned to command the Vicksburg batteries. Railroads. Of course, the most important railroad for Vicksburg is the Southern Railroad of Mississippi. It would have stretched east to west, having its beginning here at Vicksburg and having its terminus at Meridian. You have had the Mississippi Central Railroad. Now that's the railroad coming out of Jackson and going north towards Memphis. Basically, if you had the money in the mid-19th century and you wanted to build a railroad, well then you built you a railroad. The New Orleans, Jackson, and Great Northern Railroad. And by the way, you could call it anything you wanted. So if it's coming from New Orleans to Jackson, and then why don't we throw in Great Northern just to make it sound good. The Memphis and Charleston Railroad, that's going to be this one right up here, coming out of Charleston, of course, ending at Memphis, having its crossroads at Corinth with the Mobile and Ohio Railroad, another vital rail line coming out of Mobile, coming up to Corinth and then into Tennessee. These four railroads are the main body of transport, if you will, for Confederate forces in Mississippi. You do have these little spurs that do come off, the one coming from Natchez to Malcolm, then from Port Gibson to Grand Gulf, from Port Hudson to Clinton, and from Woodville down to the river as well. But the four main ones are the Southern Railroad of Mississippi, the Mississippi Central, the New Orleans, Jackson and Great Northern, and the Memphis and Charleston Railroad. Coming into Port Hudson now, Port Hudson is going to, we see Vicksburg here, Port Hudson here, in Louisiana. It was began as a small village, again situated on bluffs about 80 feet above the river, not quite as high as Vicksburg's, also on the east side of the river, and again also on a hairpin turn in the river. It was 25 miles upriver from Baton Rouge. It's about 240, 250 river miles south of Vicksburg. When the Confederates did have control of this section of the river, it really does inhibit northern commerce. vessels cannot get past Vicksburg. Coming down the river, of course, vessels that had made it to New Orleans, once they get to Port Hudson, they cannot get much past it. It is a... Confederates do fortify this area. Again, much like Vicksburg was, constructing earthen fortifications. General Pierre Gustave Touton Beauregard, who was commander of the Army of Mississippi, wrote to a Major Mansfield Lovell, commander of the Lower Mississippi, in March of 1862. Beauregard recommended the fortification of Port Hudson as a measure of precaution against the fall of our defenses north of Memphis. This drawing is from the diary of Robert Knox Snead, a Union soldier. But it does give a good point of reference as to where the fortifications would have been located. We'll have a better diagram here in just a minute. The initial plans for the fortifications were drawn up with the assistance of Captain James Noquet, who was chief engineer for General Breckinridge. There are three different layouts of earthworks that were considered. A central fort mounting cannon and supported by angled outworks. A line of lunettes arranged along a 400-yard line and a continuous ring of redoubts, trenches, and parapets surrounding the entire position. We do see a Confederate 10-inch Columbia mounted in the river fortifications at Port Hudson, a photograph taken in 1863. A little bit better diagram showing the fortifications at Port Hudson. The main fortification that we see here, a commissary fortification known as the Bullpen, and then of course these the gun positions along the river batteries. The thing that's significant about Port Hudson is that on May 27, 1863, you have the 1st and 3rd Louisiana Native Guards make an assault on the defenses at Port Hudson, and this is the first real engagement that African Americans are involved in. As we will discuss later, the Battle of Milliken's Bend on June 7th, 1863 is the second engagement where African Americans would have fought. Then the Battle of Battery Wagner in July of 1863 is the third. Of course, everybody knows the one of Battery Wagner because it is the 54th Massachusetts. And when movies with Morgan Freeman and Denzel Washington made about it, people remember it. The thing about Port Hudson, though, is it will surrender as well just 5 days after Vicksburg surrenders. When Confederate Major General Garner learns Vicksburg surrenders, he realizes there's really not much hope for himself and that basically his best option is to surrender as well. Really nothing can be gained. The terms of surrender were negotiated, and so Port Hudson does surrender on July the 9th, 1863, concluding a 48-day siege. The thing that happens with both the surrender of Vicksburg and the surrender of Port Hudson is that the trans-Mississippi states of Arkansas, Louisiana, and Mississippi and Texas are now separated from the main body of the Confederate states. All of the goods that are coming out of Texas, beef out of Texas, hogs and hominy out of Arkansas, rice, grain, and sugar out of Louisiana, men and material out of all of the states. The thing to know here is, as well, the guns, like the Enfield rifle, that are made in Great Britain, that are being transported to Matamoros, Mexico. Matamoros is a very large port of which Confederates are using to try to avoid the blockade of Confederate ports. Once these goods are unloaded, it's taken across the Rio Grande into Brownsville, Texas, brought up through Texas to Shreveport, and still on wagons brought over to Monroe, because ironically, the Shreveport to Vicksburg Railroad does not go to Shreveport. It just goes to Monroe, but from Monroe to DeSoto Point, thank you, the little community of DeSoto, where these rail cars are ferried across the river, reassembled in the rail yard at Vicksburg to be shipped further to the east. So once Vicksburg and Port Hudson are done with, all of that material no longer comes across. So it is a vital link to the Confederacy that they try to hold on to Vicksburg. Had they done so, perhaps the war would have gone on longer. That concludes my discussion on fortifications, and I will be glad to take any questions anyone might have. Yes, sir.
With the batteries, this wasn't the first time the Union had ran through naval blockade. They did it down south, they did it up north. Obviously, they learned lessons. Did the South learn any lessons and change their strategy for stopping the Union naval from driving on the fort, or were they still doing the same old thing?
It's a good point. There were really only a couple of the river batteries that were efficient enough at water battery. That is going to be right on the bend, and if you are on our on Business 61 North Washington Street, and as you are getting to the turn going to the Port of Vicksburg just before the National Cemetery, you are going to see a row of four guns right there. That is the water battery. They certainly do have a lot better angle at firing on these vessels than, say, the cannons at Fort Hill. Some of these batteries do have better angles than others. One of the things that Admiral David Dixon Porter realizes, and it kind of goes against any type of, rational thought, but let's get closer, okay? So he swings his fleet on the east side of the bank, making it more difficult for these river batteries to be able to depress their muzzles and fire effectively onto these vessels. Now, that being said, throughout the siege, you do have the Cincinnati, USS Cincinnati, one of Cairo's sister ships, is sunk twice. It's also razed twice, but you see in reports from battery number 7 and battery number 5, these batteries here do take claim as sinking that vessel. Do the tactics change? They do try to position these cannons in a little bit better location in moving them from one spot to another to try to get a better angle. But other than that, there's not much they can do. For one, the bluffs are really too high. But again, that will also pose a problem for both Admiral Farragut and Admiral Porter, because these gunboats don't have the availability to raise their muscles enough to have the effective arc that they need to be effective at trying to dislodge these batteries. The one thing that is effective are the mortar barges. The mortar barges that are going to be positioned just on the other side of DeSoto Point and some just to the south here, lobbing those. A 13-inch mortar is the largest mortar. It weighs about 17,000 pounds, and it's going to lob a 200-pound shell some 4,000 yards. And that's what really becomes effective. Yes, sir?
Well, what kind of defense did Vicksburg have in 62 when Farragut ran the battery? going upstream.
The batteries that were in place in 62 do not constitute all of the batteries that are in place for 63. Farragut is here in the summer of 1862. Confederate defenses aren't really completed until October of 1862. And with that, that's when most of the river batteries are also completed. So they weren't all in place when Farragut is making his run.
Can I?
Yes, sir.
I want to say something real quick. Understand that when he's firing on the ships that they're passing by in Porter, unless his guns are very low to the water, if they're up on a hill and he's close to the Vicksburg bank, these are barrel loading guns. And if I depress my barrel down, what happens to the projectile?
Falls down.
It wants to roll forward and get a gap in between there or roll out totally. So them coming close to the east side was important in that sense, the idea that they couldn't fire back as easily. So it made a lot of difference there.
The term is being under the gun.
Yeah.
If you be in close enough to a fortified position, there is a blackout area, a blind spot immediately in front that they cannot declinate the barrel enough to get you. So it was Porter's idea to come in and get his ships under the guns, mm-hmm. meaning he's close into that blind spot so that the Confederate defenses would be forced to fire over them and not bring direct fire to bear on the ships.
Get their smokestack.
Which, if you knock enough holes in it, it loses draft, and the boilers do go out. So, yeah, you don't want that to happen either on a coal burning ironclad. It is an effective way of getting stopped.
Colonel,
when Porter first made the attack on the 16th, the initial attack when he made around the bend, he's on the west side of the river.
Yes.
And he notices that all the artillery fire that's hitting the vessels. Hitting high, that's when he realizes that if I go to the east side of the river, they can't compress the barrels, so that's what it does.
Yes, sir.
How many, did you say how many guns total were in the river batteries?
Total number of guns in the river batteries is 47. Confederates have 42. They have 172 cannons in the Confederate arsenal. 130 of those cannons are placed on the rear line of defense. So you have 42 cannons in place in the river batteries. We actually do have those calibers and such, but that's a long list. Yes, sir, Jim.
Who constructed the Confederate fortifications primarily? Troops, slaves, mixture?
Mixture. It is a mixture. The slaves are impressed in constructing these fortifications, but what soldiers are here, and granted the Confederate garrison does not gain that 30,000 number until early in 1863, so you only have about 20,000 Confederate troops in place, but of course they are also working to try and construct these fortifications. Major General Martin Luther Smith is the commanding officer in 1862 of the Vicksburg Garrison. He is the one that really initiates the construction of these defenses because he knows after Farragut has come in the summer of 1862 that these defenses really need to be built and built to withstand an assault that he knows will be coming. Yes, sir.
Most of these defenses, they build one shovel full of dirt at a time, or they have better equipment than one shovel?
They only had about 500 entrenching tools, either pickaxe or shovel. So it took them a while. Yes, sir.
I noticed on one of the plaques it said Dahlgren gun. What is the distinction of a Dahlgren gun?
Dahlgren gun is actually just the type of cannon. Mm-hmm. It is named for Admiral Dahlgren.
Yeah, I worked at the lab, research lab, for 6 months there in Dahlgren, Virginia, but I never was told what a Dahlgren Civil War cannon was? Is it some type of...
Usually the quick way to recognize like is A, they're bomb. Big, B, they have notches in the rear, almost like the ratchet on the old bumper jacks. That was how you would raise or lower a Dahlgren, as it had its quickest recognizable feature is the notches on the back face of the gun, instead of there being a cascabel there. That's a different one. Dahlgren's usually, unless I'm confusing myself, am I confusing myself, Jake? Dahlgren's, I always thought it had the notches and stuff to raise and lower. Columbiad was a different size. It may have a similar elevation, stuff like that, but it's always the Dahlgren's. We've got a handout in different kinds. We can fact check that for you, Frank.
There was a total of one Dahlgren in the Vicksburg command. Total of one.
One of the questions that you will get, because we get quite a bit, do you notice all the terminology that Will was using for the different types of fortifications, the different kinds of the abattis, the chevaux de frise, are all from what language?
French.
Now, people will tell you, because as Americans, all we remember about the French army is it took 2 weeks to surrender to the Wehrmacht in World War II. We kind of forget that for the 400 years prior to that, remember your European history, the balance of power, the two empires that went at each other for hundreds and hundreds of years, one was the French, the other was the British. The balance of power was that France, the lilies of France, the white French infantry, were the best equipped and most technologically advanced land power on the earth for about 300 or 400 years. To counter that, Britain being an island developed the Royal Navy and made that the most technologically advanced ocean-going force on Earth. So it was always a matter that the English would land their army in Flanders and the French would cut them to pieces. The French would launch the lilies out onto the English Channel and the British would sink them. So when it came to these different terms for fortifications and defensive, they're all from the French because the French invented them. So you will get that question, why is this all in French? Well, since when was the French a big army? Well, about 400 years. World War I, they pretty much, you know, wiped themselves out in the trenches of the First World War. But yes, I've already seen the jokes on Facebook. I don't know if you heard this morning that with the trouble going on in Ukraine, France has taken the preemptive step of surrendering unconditionally. So you will get the question. We, like I say, we remember World War II and forget that they were, in fact, the army that everybody emulated for about 400 years. Was a question I saw hand up over there, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am.
Could you tell me where Southport is today, present day, and how long?
Just across the street from the Shell station on Business 61.
Used to be a car wash there.
Just north of Navy Circle, and then just up from South Fort is Louisiana Circle. Now, interestingly enough, the Widow Blakely that is positioned at Louisiana Circle is serving about a mile south of where it would have originally been. Yes, sir.
How wide was the river at Vicksburg at that time?
The river itself is much like the river it is today, other than the fact that it, when it changed its course, coming around DeSoto Point and cutting across DeSoto Point. But yeah, the river itself is typically just like the river is today. It would have been in places at least a half a mile. So it just really depends on where you are.
And DeSoto Point. And then DeSoto Point, how wide was it?
DeSoto Point wasn't but about a mile, mile and a half across.
Actually, the city, if you look at the early buildings downtown,
different houses,
it's different, the different set layout fire. Of the river relative to the town back then. And when the channel changed about 10 years after the Civil War, wasn't it?
1876. April 27th, 1876.
Yeah.
One day after Grant's birthday.
Grant's birthday. Relocated.
Yeah.
Was the land across the river at DeSoto unsuitable for any sort of fortifications or batteries?
It was. You're really looking at much like how when you cross the river today is flat, just like the Mississippi Delta. It was that. It was in many points swamp, low-lying areas. Some pieces of DeSoto Point were cultivated in row crops, but the majority of it was, you're just too low. You don't really have much to go on other than the levee. The levee, of course, would be the high point.
And when you reach the end of the line at DeSoto Point, the rail line, what was there?
A little town called DeSoto.
They offloaded the goods onto what?
They would have actually just been put onto ferries. The rail cars themselves are going to be pushed onto ferries, sent across the river, and at the rail yard at Vicksburg be reassembled to be able to be transported further east.
So it's the same gauge?
The thing about the Vicksburg rail yard is you have different gauges. Even in the rail yard, you can substitute. But I believe that the Southern Railroad of Mississippi and the Shreveport to Vicksburg Railroad were the same gauge. Yes?
I was just going to say, it's a post-war image, but on the mural wall, right, there's a mural of, I think it's probably the 1880s or 1890s, showing one of those ferries.
Okay. Ferrying the boats across. Well,
that's what they were for. The train across. The class says that the first railroad transfer of ferry was launched in 1885. But it looks like, from all the maps I've seen of the Civil War and the siege, that the railroad came up to the shore and...
Not necessarily come right up. I mean, you did have some type of a ferry-type system that would take these across. Of course, the first railroad, the first bridge across the Mississippi River is in St. Louis. James Buchanan Eads, the builder of the City-class Ironclads, constructs the first bridge across the Mississippi River in 1889. So you still have the concept of bringing these rail cars across the river is still a point of, what's the word?
In 1885, as far as we can tell, because that was pointed out, we did some fact checking. At that point, they were actually bringing the railroad cars and rolling them onto the ferry. The ferry was able to take them with trucks and wheels on and all onto it. They brought it across and just rolled them back off and hooked them up. Prior to that, the depot, the Vicksburg Depot, is not on the waterfront itself. If you look at the pictures and you look at it on the map, it's a couple blocks back in from the river itself. It's not on the riverbank, nor apparently was it at the time.
It's over by where Mississippi Hardware is, right?
Yeah, it was in. It was back in, not quite up that far, but almost that far. I believe that's what Depot Street now, isn't it?
Depot, probably closer to Depot and Pearl.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So basically, what they were doing is taking the freight off. Now, whether they actually disassembled the cars and brought them down, or they just took the freight and stuff off, used drayers to bring them down, bring them across on smaller boats. That we'd have to take a little more look into. But the 1885 date that's in there, from Jeff Jambrone's thing, that talks about when they actually made specific use ferries for the railroad with tracks right on the boats. There's numerous tracks on the belly of the boat that they could just push the freight cars right up onto, bring it across, and then just pull them right off the other side, hook them back up to a locomotive, and continue to move.
They had ferried the locomotive in 1885.
I don't believe, but not again. I don't believe so. The main reason being is that the locomotive belongs to the railroad. And since there were two separate railroads, I don't see why one railroad would not be sending their locomotives over onto somebody else's line. The freight, obviously, you're paying to bring the freight. Freight cars will do, but usually you'll change railroads. When you change rail line companies. It would just be across the way, a Shreveport and Vicksburg Rail locomotive would pick the cars up and take it from there Conversely, on this side, a Southern Railroad locomotive would pick them up and go.
Yes, sir.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, after the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou, when Grant's army formed early in 63 at Young's Point in Milliken's Bend, one of the first things, if I understand correctly, is they destroyed the railroad running from Richland all the way out to DeSoto Point.
That's correct.
And so during the siege, of course, that was of no value to them.
Yeah.
Unless goods were brought across lower, you know, like along what, the Red River, or across by boats somewhere.
Sir.
Then they still had the Interior Railroad until the siege was laid, or until Grant took Jackson and the railroad was destroyed.
Well, that's what you will see throughout the campaign. Certainly, when you get later into Grant's movements from Jackson back towards Vicksburg, they are going to do the same in regards to the railroad. They're going to tear up railroad sections of railroad, telegraph lines, cutting all communications and the availability of supply. So, yes, the rail line, once Grant is in Louisiana, he is going to make sure that this rail line is not going to be an effective rail line to resupply Vicksburg.
Well, I had a British Army officer ask me this, and I did not know what to say. Why didn't the River Battery cannon have water? Why do they use water?
Why do they use what?
Water.
Well, that is a good question.
Why do they use what? What are we talking
wadding.
About?
Wadding.
Wadding.
He told me they used it in the Crimean War, so that was before this war.
That was before this war.
Wadding.
I would think because the projectiles are still going to be, you have your powder charge, your projectile is just loaded on to those. Some of these cannons are still going to be able to fire fixed ammunition, which means the projectile is going to be attached to a wooden sabot, and that's an advancement from the Crimean War. So that's probably why there's not like a wad, if you will. I think that is outdated at this point. I don't, Jake can probably speak.
Even with the sabot on fixed ammunition, that gun's, for lack of a better term, de-elevated, thank you, depressed, I couldn't think. The weight of some of those projectiles, they don't snugly fit to the barrel like a musket ball would.
Right.
In a rifled musket.
The weight would push out the wadding.
And even if it doesn't fall all the way out, it may move a foot, and that's not good because that has an open gap, and that's how barrels burst. So.
Well, why don't we take a little bit of a break, and Jake's going to be up next, and he's going to.